Well, hey, we're going to continue through the book of Acts now in our series, The Spirit Unleashed Through the Book of Acts. Today we're going to be talking about one new people from Acts chapter 11. Acts chapter 11. Let me pray and we'll get started this morning. Father, Lord, again, Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to be here today. God, I thank you for all the brothers and sisters and friends and everyone that you've brought here today, God. There are no accidents. And so, Lord, you have something you want to say to us. And so I just pray, Lord, that even now you would once again, Lord, just prepare our hearts, Lord, and just make us moldable, Lord, and willing to put ourselves into your hands, God, the hands of the potter. You're the potter, we're the clay, God, and we pray that you would mold us however you see fit, God, that we might be pleasing in your sight. God, we do pray for the Gideon's ministry. God, I pray that you would just speed forth your word, that you would open doors that no man can shut, you would shut doors no man can open, that your word would multiply throughout the world, that even today, Lord, somebody might pick up a Gideon Bible somewhere around the world and have a life-changing encounter with Jesus Christ. And God, I pray for the Bibles that will be sent out as a result of our gifts today. God, I pray that each of those Bibles, Lord, would make it to the hands of someone who needs you, Lord, and that they would open it, Lord, and see and meet you, God, on those pages and be saved and be changed. That's the hope that we have, and we're so grateful that you met us that way. And God, we pray you'd meet some other people too. So bless us now, Lord, as we come to your word. Lord, let us be ready and willing for all that you have for us. In Jesus' name, amen. If you have a Bible, let me invite you to turn to Acts chapter 11. Acts chapter 11. And we are continuing through the book of Acts. And you'll remember now that we're at the point where Peter has had this vision and God has orchestrated all these events. And we have one of the most significant events in redemptive history, even. And that is the conversion of the first uncircumcised Gentile man named Cornelius and his household. And we saw how paradigm-shattering this was for the earliest Christians, all of whom were Jewish. And we're going to see that once again even today, that just as Peter three times fought against the Lord in the vision of the sheet descending from heaven, saying that he would never eat unclean food, so the other Jewish Christians had to learn that lesson too. If it was hard for Peter, it was certainly going to be hard for others. But they also had to learn that God was indeed creating one new people, a mixed community, united not by blood or by skin color or by religious background or by language or anything like that, but united by the blood of Jesus Christ. That's what we're going to talk about as we talk about one new people this morning from Acts chapter 11. If you're able and willing, let me invite you to stand in honor of the reading of God's word. Acts chapter 11, beginning in verse 1. Says, now the apostles and the brothers who were throughout Judea heard that the Gentiles also had received the word of God. So when Peter went up to Jerusalem, the circumcision party criticized him, saying, you went to uncircumcised men and ate with them. But Peter began and explained it to them in order. I was in the city of Joppa, praying, and in a trance I saw a vision, something like a great sheet descending, being let down from heaven by its four corners, and it came down to me. Looking at it closely, I observed animals and beasts of prey and reptiles and birds of the air, and I heard a voice saying to me, rise, Peter, kill and eat. But I said, by no means, Lord, for nothing common or unclean has ever entered my mouth. But the voice answered a second time from heaven, what God has made clean, do not call common. This happened three times, and all was drawn up again into heaven. And behold, at that very moment, three men arrived at the house in which we were, sent to me from Caesarea. And the Spirit told me to go with them, making no distinction. These six brothers also accompanied me, and we entered the man's house. And he told us how he had seen the angel stand in his house and say, send to Joppa and bring Simon, who is called Peter. He will declare to you a message by which you will be saved, you and all your household. As I began to speak, the Holy Spirit fell on them just as on us at the beginning. And I remembered the word of the Lord, how he said, John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. If then God gave the same gift to them as he gave to us when we believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that I could stand in God's way? When they heard these things, they fell silent, and they glorified God, saying, then to the Gentiles also, God has granted repentance that leads to life. Now, those who were scattered because of the persecution that arose over Stephen traveled as far as Phoenicia and Cyprus and Antioch, speaking the word to no one except Jews. But there were some of them, men of Cyprus and Cyrene, who on coming to Antioch spoke to the Hellenists also, preaching the Lord Jesus. And the hand of the Lord was with them, and a great number who believed turned to the Lord. The report of this came to the ears of the church in Jerusalem, and they sent Barnabas to Antioch. And when he came and saw the grace of God, he was glad and exhorted them all to remain faithful to the Lord with steadfast purpose. For he was a good man, full of the Holy Spirit and of faith. And a great many people were added to the Lord. So Barnabas went to Tarsus to look for Saul, and when he had found him, he brought him back to Antioch. For a whole year they met with the church and taught a great many people, and in Antioch the disciples were first called Christians. Now in these days prophets came down from Jerusalem to Antioch, and one of them named Agabus stood up and foretold by the Spirit that there would be a great famine all over the world. This took place in the days of Claudius. So the disciples determined everyone according to his ability to send relief to the brothers living in Judea, and they did so, sending it to the elders by the hand of Barnabas and Saul. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. All right, so we're going to see three things in this passage. Number one new people proved. Number two, one new people built. And number three, one new people embodied. So one new people proved, one new people built, and one new people embodied. So first, we're going to see one new people proved. So this story should be quite familiar to you by now in the book of Acts. And this account is super important, obviously, because in the unfolding of redemptive history, it shows that Christianity is the fulfillment of Judaism and the words of the prophets, okay? And we notice here that we see this account of Cornelius and the vision that he had from the angel, and then sending to Joppa, and then Peter having this vision, and then right when the vision's over, the men knock on the door, and Peter goes with them because he's prompted by the Holy Spirit. And so this whole account is repeated over and over, right? So the account of Cornelius's vision is repeated. We read about it first of all, and then it's repeated again to Peter when the messengers show up, and then it's repeated again to Peter when he shows up at Cornelius's house, all right? And then we have Peter's vision itself, which happens three times in the vision itself, the sheet descending from heaven, and then he refers to it again when the messengers come, and then he recounts the vision again when he gets to Cornelius' house. And then in Acts chapter 11, when he goes up to Jerusalem later, he recounts the entire same event all over again to the church in Jerusalem. And so the fact that Luke, as an author, is recording these events and he's repeating them over and over again, right? He's clearly trying to say something to us. He's trying to say, hey, this is important, all right? It's so important, I'm going to tell you umpteen times, so that you know how important this is for the kingdom of God, all right? That this sheet descending from heaven full of animals, including those unclean to the Jews, right? Each time God said, rise, Peter, kill, and eat, right? And we said, you know, if you're a hunter, that might be your life verse. But if you're a Jew, that's not your life verse, because you would never eat anything unclean, okay? And he had taught himself never to eat anything ceremonially unclean. And yet each time, all three times, after he refused, a voice from heaven said, what God has made clean, do not call common. And so it shows how seriously Jews took the dietary laws. The food laws were part of their Jewish identity. It's what separated them apart from the pagan nations around them. It was a marker that set them apart for God, and as we talked about, it severely limited their interactions with non-Jews, with Gentiles. Gentiles associated with all kinds of things that the law called unclean. So if you wanted to be a faithful Jew, you just wouldn't hang out with Gentiles. That's pretty much the way it had to be. Okay? And so it was very taboo for a Jew to associate with Gentiles. And so it took three times this vision descending from heaven. Three times God saying, arise, Peter, kill and eat. Three times Peter saying no. Three times God saying, what God has called common, do not call clean. And then when the people show up, the Holy Spirit, Peter said, prompted him, told him to go with them without distinction. That means going with them without discrimination or without judging them because they're Gentiles. All right? And so he goes to Cornelius' house and goes and enters into his household and even stays there, the Bible says, for a few days. All right? So this is probably the first time he's ever stayed with a Gentile in his entire life. And he stays there a few days. All right? And so if it took all that to get Peter to go along with what he was doing, we can expect that the rest of the Jewish Christians would need just as much persuasion. And so when it comes out that Peter had stayed with Cornelius all this time, they, of course, they're not too thrilled about it. They think Peter has kind of gone off his rocker a little bit, is compromising a little bit. And so they give him an interrogation next time he's up in Jerusalem. All right, but again, Peter recounts the entire story with great detail about what had happened, that God had told him that all foods are clean, and by extension, all people are clean by the blood of Jesus Christ. Now, that is good news for us because we are the ones, we're the Gentiles, we're the Corneliuses, we're the far-off ones, we're the one who, thank God, can be acceptable to God, not by the family that we were born into, but by faith in Jesus Christ. And the ultimate and climactic proof of what God was doing was the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. As we talked about last time, right, the Holy Spirit is the only true and ultimate sign that you are that you belong to God, that you are a follower of Jesus Christ. By God giving the Holy Spirit to the Gentiles, it is undeniable that they are now being brought by God into the one people of God. And in fact, Peter mentions that he remembered when he saw the Spirit coming upon the Gentiles, how it was just like the Jews had received it on the day of Pentecost. And he remembered how John the Baptist, who everybody would have remembered, and how important he was in preparing the way for the ministry of Jesus. And John the Baptist said that I baptize you with water, but one is coming after me who's the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie. All right, so remember, Jesus said John the Baptist was the greatest man who ever lived, basically in terms of the Old Testament. All right, and yet John said concerning Jesus who would come after him that he's not even worthy to untie shoes. All right, but John said about Jesus, he said, I baptize you with water, but the one who is coming after me will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. With the Holy Spirit. Okay? So in other words, just as Jesus was greater than John, so Spirit baptism is greater than water baptism. All right? And what this means is that baptism is the physical sign of a vastly more important spiritual reality of being made new by the Spirit of God. Right? So all of this is Peter's way of saying that, hey, look, they received the Holy Spirit. John was important, obviously, and baptism was important. But just as Jesus was greater than John, who baptized with water, so the baptism of the Spirit is greater than the baptism with water. Because the baptism with water is the sign, is the external sign of cleansing, but it's the Holy Spirit who actually does the internal cleansing from the inside out, all right? So in other words, it doesn't, you know, that's why, that part, you know, that's part of the reason I'm Baptist. That's the major reason that I'm Baptist, because we believe that when you get dunked with water, that is it's not a magical rite, you know. It doesn't save you. That's important, right? Because there's a lot of people out there who think that because they got wet one time, they're automatically going to heaven. But the whole point, and that's not true, by the way, the whole point of water baptism is that it's a symbol of spirit baptism. But if you haven't been spirit baptized, if you haven't been immersed, if you haven't been cleansed by the Holy Spirit of God, then you just got wet. And so that's why it's so important, because as Jesus is greater than John, so spirit is greater than water baptism. And so this is why it's so important. And of course what Peter is saying in context is because he stayed with them, he stayed with the Gentiles, and not only that, but he baptized them. All right? But he's defending himself, saying, hey, look, if they received the Holy Spirit, well, how in the world can I not baptize them? Because if they've received the real deal of spirit baptism, then water baptism is just the sign of what has already happened to them in their heart spiritually, the cleansing of the Holy Spirit. And so when he says that, you know, their feathers were kind of ruffled, and they're just like, well, I ain't got nothing to say to that. Because if somebody receives the Holy Spirit, y'all, they're saved. That's all there is to it. And so to refuse to accept somebody that God has accepted, well, then you're setting yourself up against God. And that's a serious problem. And so all this is to say that God has extended salvation, praise God, outside of the Jewish nation, and that he is creating one new people, not in Judaism, but in the person of Jesus Christ, right? And that we are cleansed not because we check certain boxes, not because we eat certain foods, not even because we get baptized or because we go to church or read our Bibles. All those things are great and important. But we are cleansed when we are transformed by the power of God through the Holy Spirit. And the Jews rightly conclude from Peter's defense that as a result of these things, God has indeed granted the Gentiles repentance that leads to life. Now, I want you to think about that for a second, because that's an important verse, verse 18. It says, they glorified God, saying, then to the Gentiles also God has granted repentance that leads to life. What they concluded then, what they are acknowledging there, is that repentance is a gift. Repentance is a gift. Faith is a gift. Life is a gift, right? The Jews understood that God was a gracious God, but the only thing is they thought they were the only ones who were getting it. God is a God of grace, and guess what? He's been gracious, thank God, to the Gentiles. Praise God, I'm a Jew. I feel sorry for everyone else out there. Oh, wait, God is giving grace to the Gentiles too. All right? That's what bothered them. That was the rub. But repentance is a gift. Faith is a gift. And from all this, they concluded, well, God must be granting grace to the Gentiles too. He's granting them repentance that leads to life. And so the great and the wonderful news about all of this for all of us is that, as we've been saying, no matter who you are, no matter where you're from, no matter what you look like, no matter what your past is like, right? That's the beauty of repentance. The whole, what does repentance mean? It means turning from your sin, right? So it's not the fact of your past sin isn't the problem. It's because here's the thing. God can forgive your past sin. That's the whole point, right? And so repentance is you turning away from your sin. So at that point, he's cleansing you of your sin. So then it's no longer a matter of what you've done. Because some people will think that. They'll say, well, you know, I've done too much in my life. There's no way God can accept me. Well, that's not how it works, all right? God accepts you not because of what you've done, but because of what he's done through Jesus Christ. And so this is what is being worked out here, that through Christ, we are one new people by faith in him. So one new people proved, number one. And then number two, one new people built. One new people built. And so we see this account of Peter and Cornelius, and that one new people has been sanctioned by God, has been divinely proved through the vision, through the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. God is doing this, so the church cannot deny what God is doing. All right? And so now the church has to come to terms with the fact that Gentiles or non-Jews can now become part of the one people of God through faith in Christ. Of course, it's going to take a while for that to completely sink in, but we see that already happening, though, in the following scene that we read about, right? Because we remember that when Stephen was martyred, right, the first Christian martyr, it says that many of the Christians were scattered out of Jerusalem. And so they spread throughout kind of the region there. And one of the outcomes of this is that some of these Jewish Christians who fled Jerusalem began to preach the gospel in places, Phoenicia and Cyprus and Antioch. Originally, they preached the gospel only to Jews, probably just assuming that, the Jews had this special place before God and all that stuff, and so not really thinking much about the Gentiles in this regard. But when all this happens with Peter, all right, and it becomes clear that God is bringing Gentiles into the one people of God, they begin to preach Christ to the Greeks also, or the ESV translates it, the Hellenists, all right, not just the Jews. But notice there, really important in verse 21, it says there that because the Lord was with them, a great number of Greeks believed and turned to the Lord. So I just want to hit the pause button on that verse real quick. Because again, right, we have to remember that to a Jewish person, right, a Gentile would have been one of those people who you would think they would be the last person on your list that's going to come to Jesus. Okay, let's put it that way. All right? And we all know, we've all experienced probably at some point in our life where maybe there's somebody that we see or someone that we know, all right? And we think, I kind of want to share the gospel with them, but then we talk ourselves out of it because we're like, you know what? They're not going to believe in Jesus. They don't care about Jesus. They might be the last person I would know that would come to Jesus. Well, that would be every Gentile for a Jew, literally every Gentile for a Jew. And yet, the Jews, they know what God's up to, right? They say, well, you know what? I'm going to preach to the Gentiles because apparently God wants to save some of them too. So they preach to the Gentiles, and what starts happening? Well, Gentiles start getting saved. Why? Because the Lord, it says, was with them. Because the Lord was with them, right? And so that is the crux, that is the ultimate, that is the mechanism by which people get saved, is you preach the gospel and the Lord is with you, and the Lord moves upon their hearts and open their eyes to see Christ and to believe the gospel, and they are saved, right? The Lord was with them, and a great number of people got saved. And so when we preach Christ with people, when we share Christ with people, their salvation isn't ultimately dependent on how smart you are, how eloquent you are, how well you say it, right? All the time people will say, well, I just don't know what to say, and what if they ask a question and I don't know the answer and all that stuff. And like, look, sorry. The point is that, look, their salvation isn't dependent on you. You share the gospel and God saves people. That's how it works. You don't have to have all the right answers. You don't have to know everything. You don't have to be the most eloquent person in the world. God used a donkey to rebuke a prophet one time. Surely he can use you to share Christ with somebody. All right? Look. God chose someone who couldn't even speak well to be his spokesperson and lead his people out of Israel. It's like when we give God excuses, what does God tell Moses? Who made your mouth? Don't tell me what you can and can't do with your mouth. I made your mouth. You can tell people about Jesus, right? Because I'm the one that saves people, right? And so that's what we do. So pray, right? Pray that the Lord will be with you. The Lord will be with you when you share, and that's how people are saved. And so this happens, and these Greeks are getting saved, and it's a really awesome thing. And the mother church in Jerusalem hears about what's going on, and they sent Barnabas up there to kind of check it out and see what's going on. But of course they sent the right man up there because it's not just the Jerusalem church there trying to be the boss and just kind of keep in check with what the Lord's doing in other parts of the world, right? But they send Barnabas because he is a man who's a righteous man who it says is a good man full of the Holy Spirit and of faith, right? And we know that Barnabas, his name means son of encouragement, so Barnabas was an encourager. So they send Barnabas there to encourage the work that the Lord is doing there, to help build up the work that God is doing there. Barnabas was a bridge builder, and he was an experienced missionary. You remember that when Saul became converted and he had to he had to get let down by a basket to escape Damascus, and he shows up to Jerusalem, and none of the other Christians want to hang out with him because he probably got some of their buddies in prison, all right? But Barnabas is the one who takes courage and vouches for Paul and helps Paul get connected with the Jerusalem church. So this is Barnabas, all right? And they send him up there to help the work, and it's a beautiful picture there because it says that when in verse 23, right, when he came and saw the grace of God, he was glad and exhorted them all to remain faithful to the Lord with steadfast purpose. He saw the grace of God and was glad. He rejoiced in the work that God was doing there. Jesus had told them, right, that they were going to make disciples of all nations, and now it was finally happening. And so he was glad when he saw the grace of God. And then he wanted that church there not just to survive, he wanted that church there to thrive. And when he saw what was going on there, he knew, and this is how we know part of how great of a man Barnabas was, because him being there, he didn't just say, you know, well, I'm the man in charge, and I'm gonna kind of take control and do all this for myself, right? No, he saw the needs there, and he thought, you know what, I need some help. And so, what did he do? He went to find Saul, because he had been acquainted with Saul, and Saul had went back to Tarsus, and he went and found Saul, or who we know as Paul, right, to go and help him, okay? And so he went and sought Paul in Tarsus. Now, Tarsus was about 150 miles from Antioch, and, you know, they didn't have SUVs back then or engines, so that was a big trip. It was 150 miles one way. But he knew that he needed Paul, and perhaps he knew that Paul needed this opportunity. And so he sought till he found Paul to bring him to help. And so let's look at some takeaways from this part of our text. The first takeaway is this, as we talked about already. The work is the Lord's, and when the Lord is with us, people will get saved. The work is the Lord, and when the Lord is with us, people will get saved. That's why we pray, and that's why we share the gospel with people. That's why we point people to Christ, and that's why we put Bibles in people's hands, right? Because the word of God saves people. This man that he mentioned was in a hotel and opened the Bible, and it literally saved his life, and not just his life, but his eternity, right? And he became a minister of the gospel. That's a testimony of what happens, you know, when you hand out Bibles. Some people just say, I'm not interested in that, and some people probably talk about you when they walk away, about these crazies out here handing out these Bibles. Well, guess what? You know, Paul thought Christians were crazy, and he got saved. So you never know what's going to happen when you just are faithful, because you do the work, you preach Christ, and then God saves people. The second takeaway is that we should rejoice when we see the work of the Lord going on somewhere else, right? The Jerusalem church sent Barnabas to encourage the work because they were rejoicing when he saw the grace of God being happening, being poured out there at Antioch, you know. And so we should rejoice, right? I mean, one of the greatest privileges, I would say, for me of being a minister in Dodge County, I would say, is the great camaraderie that we have as churches and that I have with other pastors here in Dodge County, because it's not a competition. We all have the same goal. We all have the same aim. We all have the same job. Look, guys, if every lost person in Dodge County got saved, all the church buildings in this county couldn't hold them. All right, there's plenty of room. There's plenty of room, and there's plenty of work to do. So wherever we see the Lord working, we should rejoice. Not only that, we should strive to take part in it, right? Just like they do, right? I'm sure sending Barnabas to Jerusalem was a hit to the church, and sending Barnabas to Antioch was a hit to the church in Jerusalem, right? He was a leader. He was a good man. It was hard to send him out. It was hard to let him go. But they did it because they wanted to be part of what God was doing somewhere else, right? And so we should be mindful as a church of saying, not only rejoicing in what God is doing in other parts and other places, but you say, you know what? Maybe God wants us to take a part in that. Maybe God is calling some of us to go participate in what he's doing in the world. And so, and then the final thing we can say about this passage, we learn from this passage, is to seek the right help when necessary to labor well. Seek the right help when necessary to labor well. Look, we all need help. None of us can do this alone. And I've been praying for a long time that God would send the right people at the right time to partner with us at Hillside Baptist Church so that we can thrive as a church. And I just encourage you to pray with me to that end, that God would send the right people at the right time, like he sent Saul to Barnabas, with Barnabas there, to Antioch, to labor together, to see the work continue to thrive. Okay? And so these are some lessons that we learned. And then the final thing I want to point out here is it says there that in Antioch it was the first time that the believers were called Christians. And what I want you to notice there is that the Christians didn't call themselves Christians, right? It says that they were called Christians. Now, I just want to make that point to say this, that what Christians called each other, that Christians called each other brother or sister. They called each other saint. They called each other followers of the way. The term Christian, it wasn't made up by Christians. It was made up by Romans. The word in its origin is a Roman, it's a Latin word. So most likely the Christians were called Christians by the Roman governmental officials there in the church at Antioch. Okay? And so what does it mean? It means probably that they just were a people who were there, who became a sizable part of the city, who just talked so much about Jesus that they didn't know what else to call them except Christians. You know, those people talk about Christ all the time, aren't you? And I was, what a beautiful thing to be called Christian from the outside is probably a term of derision. But they owned it and said, you know what, that is who I am. Because I do love Jesus, and Jesus has given everything for me, and I am going to talk about him because of what he's done for me. So they didn't call themselves Christians, they were called Christians. So what do we see? We see one new people proved, one new people built, and finally here, one new people embodied. And we'll just be real quick here. The church there in Antioch. Antioch was the third largest city in the Roman Empire. And the church, apparently a large number of Greeks had believed and all this stuff. So it was a large city. There was a sizable number of people there. We can imagine that the church in Antioch probably had some means, probably had some resources, all right? Well, a prophet from Jerusalem comes up to Antioch and named Agabus, and he foretells of a famine that's coming. And it's said that famine happened in the days of Emperor Claudius, and we do have some historical evidence of famines that happened at that time. They weren't terribly uncommon, in fact, food shortages. But this prophecy that a famine is going to happen, okay? And so what does this church do? Well, this church says, you know what? We have some means. The church in Jerusalem is struggling. And remember, right, that after the persecution of Stephen, the church in Jerusalem fell out of favor with the Jewish authorities, right? And they were kicking them out of the synagogues and all that stuff. And so we can probably imagine that some of them were losing their jobs, or some of them couldn't find employment because they were Christian and things like that. And so the church in Jerusalem was having a hard time. And so you have this church in Antioch that's full of Gentiles, not Jewish people, but they're Christians. And they know that they have fellow brothers and sisters in Christ in Jerusalem who are going to be having a hard time. So what do? So they determine to do something about it. And they say, we're going to help them. And notice most of them probably, most of the Gentiles especially, probably didn't even know a single Jewish Christian in Jerusalem. But they said, you know what? I'm going to help them because they're my brother and sister in Christ. Right? And so what's the point? It's John 13:34, right? A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you're to love one another. By this, all people will know that you're my disciples if you have love for one another. And so what's the point? The point is that the world will know that we belong to Christ when we love one another. The world will know that we belong to Christ when we love one another. So what is this? It's this one new people being embodied, right? It's them saying, you know what? I may be a Jew, and I may be a Jew and they may be a Gentile, but you know what? We're brothers and sisters in Christ. And as I said before, right, there's no difference today that was greater than the differences were between Jew and Gentile. And yet they said, you know what? That our unity in Christ is vastly more important than what the differences that we have. And so they said, we're going to help them. And it was that love that demonstrated and that built that unity for Christ. And so as I close this morning, we've had this opportunity to talk about this one new people of God. And it's a family. It's the family of God. It's a community of people who together have been transformed by God and by the power of the Holy Spirit. And I'm just going to tell you, there's nothing like it. And so as we close today, and we're going to sing a song of response here in just a moment, but I just want to say that what this early church experienced, this story kind of that we read today, it's not just a story, it really happened. But the most important thing about this story is that the story is still happening today. God is still saving people through the proclamation of His Word. God is still welcoming people who might seem far off. We might think we ourselves are far off from God, and God is saying, actually, you're not as far off as you think. In fact, I've brought you here today to bring you into my family. And so this opportunity, this one new people that we can share, not just in this room, but with brothers and sisters all around this world, that invitation to be part of that family is extended to you today. You can turn from your sins, you can trust in Christ, and then no matter how different we are, no matter what you look like, no matter what your past has been like, you can become part of this family, and you can become part of the family of God. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this morning. I thank you for the opportunity to worship you. And above all, God, thank you for the gift of being able to belong to you through Jesus Christ. Lord, it's a privilege, Lord, to be able to look at the people in this room and say, they're my brother, they're my sister in the Lord. Part of a family, God, that will last forever. Lord, and maybe today, God, maybe today someone just, God, maybe they need a family today in a way that they've never had before. And Lord, you're just inviting them in. And I just pray, God, that your Spirit would just help them see that you are Lord, that you are alive, that you've risen from the dead, that you've died on the cross, that you have done everything necessary, Lord, to make right our wrongs, to correct, to fix our messes, Lord, so that we can become part of your family forever. And so I pray, Lord, that if you're tugging at their heart, God, I pray that they would answer. Lord, answer that call to belong to you, to know you, to find joy that can only be found in you. Let it be, Lord, we pray in Christ's name.